good morning to everyone present here today. We have joyfully congregated to celebrate the mother's 145th birth anniversary. We shall begin by hoisting the mother's flag, followed by the salute.
We shall now listen to the concentration music.
Oh,
Now please be seated.
We shall now listen to a chanting of Vedic mantra in Sanskrit to pay our tribute to the Divine Mother.
Sarvebhyo Namo Namaha. Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om. Sahana Bhavatu, Sahana Bhunaktu, Saha Viryam Karvavahai, Tejasvinavadhi Tamastu, Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Om Sham No Mitra Sham Varunaha, Sham No Bhavatyar Yama, Sham No Indra Brihaspati, Sham No Vishnu Rudukramaha, Namo Brahmane. Namaste Vayo, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi, Tvameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami, Ritam Vadishyami, Satyam Vadishyami, Tanmavatu, Tadvaktaramavatu, Avatu Mam, Avatu Vaktaram. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Om Purnamada, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachate, Purnasya, Purnamadaya, Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Om Anandamai Chaitanyamai Satyamai Parame. Om Anandamai Chaitanyamai Satyamai Parame. Om Anandamai Chaitanyamai Satyamai Parame.
Expressions will now perform a skit entitled The Mother and Beauty.
A thing of beauty is a joy forever. The mother's life was, is, and forever will be beautiful to us. It is a source of joy and inspiration to us. The mother was born in Paris on 21st February 1878 to Maurice Alfasa, a Turkish banker, and to Matilda Ismaloon, an Egyptian lady. She was born with exceptional qualities, and one such quality was to be able to create something positive out of any negative influence, or to create beauty where it was lacking. She realized that even as a child, she was born for things more sublime. At one instance, Mira says that when as a child, she used to complain to her mother about food or any such matter. Her mother would send her packing saying, "You are born to realize the highest ideal." These experiences touched Mira's sublime soul. And it is no surprise then that even at 5 years of age, Mira is said to have sat in meditation on an armchair, feeling that she did not belong to this world. She would sit and feel this consciousness always above her head. At that age began her spiritual discipline, her sadhana. Mira saw many things which were far from being beautiful. She saw meanness, ugliness, and lies. She asked herself why people behaved this way and why life was this way. For instance, other children, her playmates, would treat her roughly and not play with her. But she never returned this unkindness. She would return home, meditating and questioning the consciousness she felt above her head. Throughout her life, to all hostile forces, Mira was an invincible warrior. "If you can always smile at life," she wrote once, "life will always smile at you." At the age of 12, Mira would go on lonely walks to the forests of Fontainebleau near Paris. She would sit quietly under a tree, going into deep meditation. Her consciousness communed with the birds and trees. Squirrels would come close to her and play with her fearlessly. Perhaps they too realized the beauty of her soul.
Another revealing experience of the mother's beautiful life is from her prayers and meditations, where she writes that at about 13 years of age, every night after she had gone to bed, she went out of her body and rose above her house and even above her city. She says, "I would see myself clad in a golden gown, and men and women and children, those sick and poor and unfortunate, would try to come to her, and when they touched her robe, they were healed and happy." But life for Mira was not one-sidedly an inner life only. She could be firm and resilient if it was a question of fighting for the truth or protecting comrades. Once, she had to face a much bigger child who used to bully younger girls. One day, she asked him, "Will you shut up now?" When he continued, she lifted him up and threw him on the ground. The mother later wrote that it was Mahakali, the divine warrior force, that had descended into her. The mother's exceptional persona is revealed to us also through her pursuit of the sport of tennis. She started playing when she was only 8. She would often deliberately play with older children. She lost in those games, but she did not seem to mind at all, for she learnt a lot and slowly became a much skilled player. Mira's inner strength was strong and exceptional. A singular event in the mother's life was her discovery of the Bhagavad Gita. When she was 21, an Indian gifted a French translation of it. The Indian advised her to envisage Krishna as the immanent Godhead, as the divine within ourselves. The Gita enriched the mother's inner realization and spiritual radiance.
The mother had always felt irresistibly drawn to India, the one country she had always felt to be her true mother country. On 29th March 1914, her dream was fulfilled. The first physical meeting with Sri Aurobindo was a decisive experience for the mother, and she
immediately recognized in him the one whom she had so often met in her dreams and whom she had called Krishna. She writes, "I seem to have at last arrived at the threshold which I have long sought." Unfortunately, the mother had to return to Paris that very year because of the outbreak of the First World War. The separation from Sri Aurobindo and from India was a shock for her. However, Sri Aurobindo continued his correspondence with the mother, and the mother travelled to Japan in 1916 and stayed on for 4 years. She says, "For 4 years, from an artistic point of view, I lived from wonder to wonder." The mother, who had studied art and was an accomplished artist, loved the beauty of the Japanese landscapes, the perfect arrangement of the houses, which were one with the nature. She admired the energy and discipline of the Japanese. She soon adopted a Japanese style of living, wore the kimono, and learned Japanese flower arrangements. However, the mother longed to return to India. In April 1920, the mother returned to Pondicherry, and this time for good. From here on, her spiritual collaboration with Sri Aurobindo was uninterrupted. In 1926, after the descent of the Overmind, the mother took charge of the ashram. In 1952, the mother established the Sri Aurobindo International Center of Education, whose primary aim was to allow young souls to grow into a higher life through a comprehensive, integral education. On 28 February 1968, the mother established Auroville, the city of dawn, to realize human unity. It was to be a universal town where men and women were able to live in peace above all religion, all creed, all nationalities. Western vocals will now sing for you John Lennon's iconic song, Imagine, a song that reflects this ideal of human unity.
Thank you.
We hope you have liked Askatan song. The beautiful charts were prepared by Somlata Guha, Prerna Singh Gupta and Vedpurna Das Gupta of Class 4B and Anish Devadikari of Class 4A. We pray to our spiritual guides, Sri Aurobindo and the Divine Mother, that they continue to bless us and guide us through their living presence.
Our tribute to the mother through various physical activities. The mother says, in the general program of the child's education, sports and outdoor games should be given a prominent place. Class 4 shall now perform Surya Namaskar.
Surya father says, we must, by means of a rational and clear-seeing physical education, make our bodies strong and supple. We shall now watch the students of class 5 perform a pom-pom drill.
Thank you. April.
Thank you.
your receptivity. Flowers are therefore a means of transmitting messages of strength, protection, hope, and joy.
Quand je vous donne des fleurs, disait la mère, je vous donne des états de conscience. Les fleurs sont messagères et leur efficacité dépend entièrement à votre réceptivité. Les fleurs sont donc un moyen de transmettre des messages de force, de protection, d'espoir, de joie.
Must be rigorous and detailed. far-sighted and methodical. In keeping with this, the students of Eurythmics will now put up a performance.
Y el te botan pelo diente. Tú quieres jugar, pásame los 20. Tú quieres jugar, pásame los 20. Tú quieres jugar, pásame los 20. Si no, te botan pelo diente. Pásame la maldita manguera, si no te voy a hacer tu lío. Aquí mismo, ¿qué fue? Let me see it.
We'll be right back. And be witness to a spectacular celebration of the mother's life. I would not be overstating if I said that all of us, teachers and students, have put up nothing short of a spectacular show. And I include all items put up by all children and all teachers. Thank you ever so much. Thank you, dear parents, for sharing this joy with us. On her 80th birthday, the mother said something to the effect that to celebrate the birth of a transitory body is not such so great. Then she said, to celebrate the birth of the divine consciousness can be done at every moment in the history of the world. But to celebrate the birth of a new world, the supramental world, is a unique and exceptional privilege. It is this supramental world that Sri Aurobindo spoke of in his magnum opus, The Life Divine, beginning with the chapter The Human Aspiration and ending with the chapter The Divine Life. This is the same supramental manifestation that he spoke of when he composed his smallest book, The Mother. In the last paragraph he says, the supramental change is a thing decreed. But the thing that he said will make it happen is the presence and power of the Divine Mother. That is what we celebrate today. The physical advent of the Divine Mother on 21st February 1878, and you've heard all the accounts of it. I shall move a little bit and I'll talk to you about the significance of this particular ceremony this morning. And I'll start by telling you a little bit about our parent body. As you know, the Future Foundation School's parent body is? Anybody? Sri Aurobindo Institute of Culture. Does that name sound familiar? Sri Aurobindo Institute of Culture's chairman, and it's a line of unbroken succession, is a trustee of the Sri Aurobindo Ashram Pondicherry. Our current chairman, Sri Manoj Das Gupta, on 22nd October, is 89. And he has been our chairman now for about 30 years. Right? And maybe more. Well, 30 years here. And I think as a trustee of the ashram, he became a trustee in the year 1984 at the demise of the secretary of Sri Aurobindo Ashram, Sri Murlikanta Gupta. Manojda, as he is known by everybody, big or small, went to the ashram when he was about 5 years old. And this was a time of the Second World War. He was born in, I think, 1938, if I'm not wrong. And, well, we have to calculate that. And it was in the middle of the Second World War that his father took him to the ashram because this part of the country was deemed unsafe. And there were many such children who went there. And it is for them the mother created the ashram school, which she renamed the Sri Aurobindo International Center of Education. Mother was the first and the foremost teacher of that institution. She taught children, she played with them, she created a tennis ground, a playground, and a sports ground for indulging in all kinds of sports that could have been imagined. And she invited Olympians to come and display. What was the reason? She didn't want everybody to become Olympians. The facilities she created in the late 40s and in the 50s were such that they matched Olympic standards, something that was unseen and unheard of in independent India. She did that to fulfill that part of Sri Aurobindo's dream, you see. Because right from the beginning of the world, there have been many prophets who have come, who have told us about the divine and who have gone, we have remained very much the same. There has been a transformation in many of our inner selves, what we are within. But the world can only change if what is without can also be transformed. That is the motto of this school, by the way. The perfection of all the parts of our being, physical, mental, vital and psychic. Those who have not read it up, please do. These are the four elements of our being that we seek to perfect. Of them, the psychic, spiritual, even the vital and the mental have been worked upon for ages, for centuries. It is the physical that is the most gross, the most rigid and the most difficult. That is why we need to develop in it strength, flexibility, endurance, and suppleness. And in the ashram, from that time on, from the mid-40s, till today these qualities are cultivated. In the ashram, taking part in physical education is compulsory, meditation is not compulsory. So let me tell you this with a great pride. This is one ashram which believes that the body, because that's the most difficult to change, needs to be perfected. It is, I asked the mother once in a letter, the purpose of meditation. And so I realized at a very small age that this was an ashram which endeavored the transformation of all the parts of our being. In our modest way, we try to emulate that brilliant example humbly as an offering to the mother on this day and on 15th August, Sri Aurobindo's birthday. Two of Sri Aurobindo's last essays in his life were Perfection of the Body and the Divine Body, which were serialized in his book, The Supramental Manifestation Upon Earth. I can only say in the mother's words to you, because you see, through that ashram school, that school and the people who came out from it still form the senior most cadre of ashramites of the ashram. Till a year or two ago, Manojda was the most active band player of the ashram band. I have seen Nonnida marching, Nonni Kantagupta's predecessor, and Nirodh Bolu Sri Aurobindo's attendant in March past in their 90s. It's compulsory, as I told you, that they have tried their heart and soul all through their life to give shape to Sri Aurobindo's and the mother's dream. That is what we try to do. And in the mother's words, I tell you, I salute you, she says, my brave little soldiers, I give you my call to the rendezvous with victory. This is not just the victory of good over evil. It is the victory over our foolishness, over our stupidity, over all that envelops the world in terms of war, bloodshed, loss of human life, lack of ideals, how to live life, victory over all that so that a nobler, brighter and better race can inhabit the world. Sri Aurobindo said, we are sons of God and must be even as He, His human portion, we must grow divine. Victoire la douce.
Thank you, sir, for your warm, touching and inspiring words. We shall now sing the Vande Mataram. I shall request everyone to please stand up. Come to the end of today's program. There are beautiful charts depicting the life of the mother that have been made by students of all classes. A lot of effort and love and reverence for the mother has gone into making these charts. We shall appreciate if you can just spare some moments and have a look at them. They have been arranged along the passage of the dining hall. Thank you for being here with us. We hope you have a great day ahead. I shall now hand over the mic to Satya sir for dispersal.
Good morning all. We are asking the participants to please move towards your classrooms. Parents, be seated. We'll tell you when to move and collect your work from the classrooms and which classrooms. Bachelors and house members can leave. Non-participants, please start moving.